Okay, so welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We are on the Sunday Night Sex Show. I'm your host, Sean Evans. I'm with Tony Lee, the X-Rated Hypnotist. And you might know this guy from Kenny vs. Spenny. The G-Rated Idiot. Okay.
And Drucknar from...
Ruknar
from Vikings.
From Vikings.
He had an amazing person do this ponytail. Turn around and let them see it.
I don't know if they can see it, but...
Well, I can in that one. He's got, by the way, any burglars in town, he's got lots of iPads here.
Sure, why not, right?
And hit the pawn shop and it'll be worthwhile.
So, tonight we're here to talk about sex with two people that have been around the block, for sure, no doubt. Tony has been touring. How long have you been touring doing your hypnosis show?
32 years now.
32 years at colleges and universities across Canada.
Yeah.
The UK.
UK, New Zealand, the Emirates, lots of places.
Lots of places. Into the US as well a little bit?
Yeah, a little bit in the US. We've, it's probably done about 9,000 live shows in 32 years.
9,000?
Yes.
Fuck.
Yeah, we lost count. It's, you know, I'm not going to lie, but I think the amount of alcohol we've consumed in that time frame.
Played its part?
It's played its part in the breaking the time...
Continuum.
Sure.
So it all seems...
It feels like 2 years, but it's actually been 32 years.
It all seems like a blur?
Yeah.
So, I mean, a lot of people probably, I know myself from the outside looking in, you think, wow, this guy's going to colleges and universities, hypnotizing people. He's a pretty big deal. How much is he getting laid? Like, what's your sex life been like over the last 32 years?
You know what? The persona that we have on Facebook is actually the, it's weird, because it's the opposite of who I actually am. Because, you know, it started out as something 32 years ago, and material that was making me laugh, and, you know, merged into doing a lot of these clubs. These clubs were selling out. We were doing 500 to 2,000 people. It was like that. We were doing 300 shows a year. And yeah, we're hammered every night. We're out. We're partying. But the reality is I've always had a girlfriend. And,
yeah.
Yeah. So I've never really had that opportunity.
So you've never been a man whore. You've been...
No. But you know what? I've wanted to be.
Sure.
I take a look at some of my friends. I go, wow, you know what? Something's missing. But I never could. I always had a girlfriend. I was always dedicated. And
your relationship guy.
Yeah. Boring.
Okay. So... I appreciate that. I think that's great. I mean, for anyone that doesn't know Tony, he's got a huge heart, and you're in another relationship now, is that correct?
Yeah, you know what? It's quite amazing. I told myself, I think I say this every time, that's it after my last one.
Yeah.
But you know, I don't know, maybe perhaps it's the age difference, maybe it's perhaps it just wasn't the right chemistry, and but you know what? This one's amazing.
It's good.
You know, I don't want to get into detail.
And you don't want to jinx it, yeah?
Yeah.
Fair enough. It's fairly new,
but,
right?
So she lets you do anal, basically.
No, but you know what? See, I'm not into that. Are you? Do you like anal?
Let's talk about that.
Why are you talking to him right now?
Yeah, no.
Because we'll get to me.
All right, we'll get to you.
Well, I figured, no, you know, and there's nothing. It's to each his own, you know? And if somebody wants to do anal, they do anal. I just figured there's, in my optics, it's like, hey, there's another hole that feels, in my opinion, probably a lot better than the other one. So
really?
I don't know.
Have you ever tried anal?
No.
Really? I'm surprised, because we talk a lot about anal sex on stage.
I know. So it's, it never...
Again, the persona versus the real you, right?
Yeah, I know, and it never... never happened. Not only that, but I'm a little short, so I don't know if I maybe have another phone book.
Yeah, just so that everybody knows, do you want to point this out?
Yeah, Tony is sitting on a pillow.
Really?
Where am I? Look, really? I'm Tourette syndrome. I'm like,
look at this one.
He's
this
sitting on a pillow to get an extra butt.
Really? Why?
And it's sinking down. You're not even... Why? Because your vanity makes me laugh. You're very handsome.
God.
Look at the muscles on him.
Okay. Yeah, for sure. I agree. So let's get to you. Let's get to you, Spenny. Those of you that don't know Spenny, you had a very successful reality TV show for 6 seasons, correct?
With the Christmas special, the first season was 26 episodes, so it was really 7 seasons.
About 7 seasons?
Yeah, something like that.
So, when did you start this? How many years ago?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
Okay.
So I'm terrible with chronology.
Fair enough. So, and you started based out of Toronto. Is that your Toronto?
No, we actually, we sold the show in Los Angeles.
Okay.
We were working with Will Smith's company, Overbrook Entertainment. They optioned us and paid us to come out there and pitch shows. And the USA Network, which was Barry Diller's network at the time, I don't know if it still is, liked our pitch, and not him personally, but a guy named Stephen Chow.
Yeah.
And he ordered a pilot.
Okay.
And then halfway through the pilot, they pulled the plug. And I'm not ever sure why, but that's fine. So we both went to film school and we finished it ourselves.
You and Kenny both gone to film school?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, Kenny never went, actually.
Right.
He just went to the room where they rented or gave the cameras away, and he'd use the camera and you wouldn't see him again for a few weeks.
Okay.
I actually went to class.
Yeah.
But anyways, so then we sent that finished pilot to a guy named John Moranis, who at the time was with Alliance. Maybe it was Alliance Atlantis, I don't remember.
Okay.
He almost vomited laughing.
Yeah.
And then like a year after that, he got his 26 episodes on CBC.
Nice.
Yeah.
And then you went to
Showcase.
Yeah. Right. And that was when you were allowed to use profanity, correct?
Well, Showcase was cable, so it was a lot different. The odd thing is when we were on CBC, we were literally the show right before Peter Mansbridge and the national news.
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know our show, it usually ended up with me doing some kind of humiliating act because I either lost or was cheated out of winning the competition. I would be bobbing for apples in a toilet, and then 2 minutes later, and now the news with Peter Mansbridge.
Do you have, on those humiliations, do you have one that sticks in your mind as the most humiliating out of all of them? Or a few of them that you would classify as like...
You know, no one ever asked me that question.
No?
Yes! Constantly, I'm sick of it.
All right, well then we'll just get into your sex life.
His tongue, no, let's stick with this.
Yeah, thing. Okay.
The tongue scraping where Kenny took a card and scraped his disgusting, phlegmy, I don't even know what liquid came off of it, and it was just this white thing, and then he dabbed it on my, and I had to hold it out for, but I... The smell of it came up in my nose and
was vomiting. I remember when we did that live.
Yeah, we've done it live.
We've done that live.
We actually do Kenny versus Spenny live. Tony is our man. Well, he's my manager and he runs the tours for us. So
yeah, but you threw up that first time. That
I probably did.
Yeah. So we get a bucket out every time,
Just in case.
So yeah.
Oh, shit.
So
my worth was measured in vomit.
Did you ever think that the show was going to be as successful as it was?
Not really.
No? Was it just kind of something you were planning on doing for fun, or did you really think you could make a career?
Well, no, I knew I was going to be in the business. I went to school for it. So you just can't predict what shows are going to hit or not going to hit. It has to do with what the network books behind it.
Right.
You know, are people seeing it? When is it on?
Yeah.
But it was so monumentally stupid that people really dug it. And, you know, here we are.
Yeah.
I mean, we were on Conan. We were on Jimmy Kimmel. We had Matt and Trey from South Park produced season 4 of our show. We were on in the States. We had a really good run.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And now you're here with me. How do you feel about yourself right now?
No band, nothing. No green room, no fruit plate.
Yeah, no fruit plate.
No smoked fish plate.
Just instant coffee.
But you know what? I want you to know that this is, you know, I'm honored because this is like, I've never done it.
This is the real deal, buddy.
Real deal.
Yeah, I appreciate having you on. So let's get into the sex life. I mean, you obviously, you know, you measured some great success that was unexpected. How did you, like, were the women flocking at you, or how was that?
Well, I'm a guy who, you know, shit his pants on TV and you know, was pretty much humiliated. They weren't exactly lining up.
Okay.
But having said that, the exposure you get from TV in a very superficial sense makes you attractive to superficial people.
Sure.
And that was always the thing, you know, but, and then it was, you know, you took advantage when I was single. I'm a married man now.
Yep.
And, you know, I took advantage a little bit here and there. But most of the time, the people that would want to be with me because I was on the stupid TV show weren't really interested.
To
me.
You know, to find somebody that's actually real.
Yeah.
Somebody that doesn't know who you are or what you have or what you do. And I think there's a little bit of, you know, it's attractive. The lifestyle consumes you. It's exciting. Like,
yeah.
You know, and I tell people all the time, it's like, you know, we're on the road. Imagine this. And imagine a night out with you and your buddies having the greatest time. And, you know, you meet that beautiful woman and you work there and it's just the best night ever. And the next day you do it again. You go, wow, it's 2 nights in a row. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Now imagine doing that 9,000
times.
Sure. At some point in time, it breaks, and then I find that you have to sit back and then you realize that you're in this world that it's filled with great people, and we've made some great friendships, don't get me wrong, there's some genuine friendships on
100%.
It, but then the other side of it is you're living this world that isn't real. It's very you don't know why people want to be around you or with mm-hmm. you. It's to find somebody that doesn't care about that is
that sees you for who you are.
Yeah, sure.
Not just
so.
Not I just, try to get them to see me for not who I am, because that would be a disaster.
But okay, so I mean, when you talk about women taking advantage of the single life, obviously we don't have to get into numbers. But what was some of the craziest experiences that you got yourself into sexually?
You go to a strip joint. For some reason, strippers love Kenny versus Spenny, or maybe they just love anyone that's on TV. So a couple of times things happen that way. I don't know if it was that crazy. I mean, you know, we're not the Rolling Stones
on tour. I know.
It's sort of a low rent thing. But what do you want? You want me to say something completely?
No, man. I'm curious myself.
Yeah. No. Well, you were on TV. Wait a second. We probably had more viewers watching you than we had. You were on ABC?
No, it was ABC.
ABC. ABCs.
I mean, The Bachelor and The Bachelorette, they're big shows, but they kind of skyrocket you into this world that you didn't know existed.
Right.
Very quickly and very when you're not prepared for it. But it also falls just as quick.
Right.
Because there's nothing really continuing. It's not like I have episode after episode after episode, week after week after week. Unless this takes off, but other than that.
What about our show?
Well, our show, yeah. So for those of you watching, Tony is our manager, and we do a show called Sex Coach University, in which I'm with this fellow here, and we go to colleges, universities. Yep. It's a funny way to educate the students on sex, as well as what would you say after we put our show together, what would you classify it as?
I think it's the universities put out, educators or people in the field,
right.
And they do these live events that nobody shows up to because they're, you know, pretty serious about the content and people want to have fun.
Yeah.
So Tony's idea was to, give them the content but make it entertaining.
Yep.
So he matched us together because, as you probably know, if you watch this podcast, Sean is a certified sex coach and he knows a lot of stuff. I think it's great what he's doing. And so I'm there to just yuck it up a bit, to be honest about my situation if the people in the audience aren't opening up, which sometimes happens.
Sure.
And we just try to, make fun of it, but also impart important information. The difficult thing for me is the sexual assault part of it, because there's not a lot of fun in it, but yet a lot of it happens on the university and college campuses. So I feel, to really get to the guys mostly, because let's be honest, it's mostly guys that are committing these sexual assaults.
Well, we are gender neutral, but if you take a look at the stats.
One of
the things that, what frustrated me is I can remember, this hasn't been a new thing. It's got to be probably 7 years ago. When there were a lot of sexual assault cases. We were working with Darlene Barrier, and we tried to put together a program and launch it on the university college circuits. And even though it's a mandate that everybody supported, the problem is you got to understand is you bring something not that on board, even though you want to promote the message, but then it's also saying, well, is this optically maybe saying that we have a problem on our campus? So we didn't have a lot of success booking events and lecture speakers that spoke on sexual assault because of the optics, for whatever political reasons. So,
well, the reason is the university doesn't want to be associated with that. So in the States, for example, they had a lot of women who would complain this happened and the institution did nothing about it. And I think the reason for that is they don't want parents to think they're going to send their kids away to a place where something harm can come to them.
Sure.
Well, in essence, whatever is, whether they did do anything or whether they didn't, what we've done, in essence, we just put together a fun educational type of program. But how do you create something that's fun without...
With chlamydia.
Yeah, well, I'm talking about the sexual assault, without you know, because you got to be careful not to.
You don't want to make
you
make
don't
want
to make light
that.
Of it, right?
Yeah,
so,
sure.
But we spent a long time coming up with a formula to do that. You know, with the sex toy bingo stuff that Spenny does, where you're putting messages in between that, so people are coming out, they're enjoying themselves, but they're still getting a positive message. And it's no different than the stuff that you're doing as well as certified sex coach, and as well as focusing on many aspects, also including mental health, the results of mental health and everything.
And there's a lot of things these students are going to get into and have, you know, things happening in their lives that it's not pertinent right now, but
it could
being
be.
Older,
yeah, sure.
You know, they're going to have to deal with it. So, you know, I'm pretty honest about my sexual life to and Sean, you know, will talk to me and I'll start the conversation going.
Yeah.
And we just want to have an open conversation, because the worst thing that can happen with this stuff, especially sex, because it still is sort of taboo, believe it or not, even in today's world with the internet and porn available everywhere, I still find that people aren't as honest as they should be about these issues.
No.
Would you agree?
I agree 100%. I think that the whole key behind this, and the whole reason behind even doing this shit, is the transparency aspect, is because the more that you can be open and honest, it's going to encourage other people to do the same.
Yeah, and it's very healthy.
It is healthy. Yeah, fucking 100%. Like, I have zero skeletons in my closet right now, and I can't tell you can't do anything to upset me, because I've talked about my drug use. I've talked about mental health issues and breakdowns. I've talked about all this shit.
What about the beard?
Yeah, the beard is just a woman pleaser.
Okay. That's
you found that out in the show.
That's unbelievable.
You know, I tried to grow one.
Yeah.
Right? It doesn't come out that...
He looks like Fu Manchu.
I was waiting for that.
He can look pathetic so easily.
So let's be transparent with everybody watching. So people want to know about these crazy... And I know that there may not have been something so crazy. So let's just talk about, like, what was the most shocking thing you've ever done?
Well, I think a woman, you know, if I... Any woman that likes me is crazy.
Yeah.
And we can get into that whole theory that we discussed once.
And you managed to land yourself a pretty sweet wife. I've met your wife.
She's absolutely...
Yeah, so I don't know how you pulled that one off, but she watched
it. You know why? No, that's why.
That's why, okay.
She, and she still won't watch it
good
because
for you.
Then the divorce will come right after.
But that's actually an interesting point, because working as an X-rated hypnotist and doing the things we've done over 33 years... At the end of that, you know what, I do get approached by a lot of it. Sometimes I'm oblivious to it because we're so used to it. I'm you know, I'm going to the green room, packing up and everything. So sometimes I don't know when people are approaching me or they're interested. But then the ones that are predominantly interested have a different optic of who I am, because you see this aggressive guy on stage doing the most, you know, fucked up shit, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a performance.
But they think that I'm that guy, right?
Right.
And I go, fuck, I'm going to disappoint them, right? But,
sure.
You know, thank God I'm at a girlfriend, and, you know, I never did that. Never took anybody home from
right.
my
33 years. You can't be telling us the truth.
Yeah. 30, yeah, yeah.
33 honestly, years, man.
You know, I've been
there accused. There should be an award for that.
Yeah, it's weird. I mean, somebody, Kim, a girl that I was a friend of mine in December, called me a serial monogamist, and I don't even know if that's a word.
Yeah,
no,
it's a popular phrase.
Yeah,
But that's okay. I just I have to have that emotional bonding. And you know what? It's and when you talk about, you know, sexual performance, this, that, if you become the product of your environment, if you're around somebody that's like negative and they don't give that energy off, it's not going to work, right? It's not
right.
Things aren't going to work, and you know, when you find somebody that has that spark, like it's, I feel like I'm 20 years old again. It's like I can't help but to smile right now, because it's fucking awesome.
Good,
like,
for you, buddy.
Like,
don't do a Tom Cruise and start
jumping.
It's the physical, the emotional side of things, and I never thought I'd find that, because I wasn't looking for it, but it was,
it's there now.
Yeah, I can't explain it.
Yeah.
It's
amazing. We can see that clearly.
So the whole time that you've been touring, this 33 years, I've done your show with you.
Yeah.
You've taken like 5 tequila shots in a row sometimes. You're not
at
even...
At least,
yeah. Sometimes it's 10 tequila shots.
Yeah.
And you're still not, like, you still haven't done any one-night stands or anything like that. How is that fucking pot? I would not be able to. Like,
well,
I,
you know what? If you think about it...
You should be ashamed of yourself.
At the end of the shows, you know, what is, you know, you got a few hundred to thousands of people in the audience at the end of this, at the end of the night. I realized I've just been up there for 90 minutes.
Yeah,
exhausting.
And yeah. It's awesome. I'm soaked, and I want to get back to the green room and catch my. By the time that happens, and I go back out, and people stick around, and we take pictures and do signing ops and whatever else. But you know, and even if there was somebody there that you might be interested in. You know, there's another 10 people behind them, so you don't really get a chance to talk to them by the time everything's done with.
And then they think you're not interested because you're trying to meet everybody.
Yeah, you know, and it's and that's okay too, because it wasn't something I was really looking for.
We're on our most likes yet.
Oh, that's cool. Is anybody asking any questions that they want to know? No? Okay.
Yeah, but maybe we should say that. It's
if you want to ask any question, we've got someone looking at the iPad, so go ahead and comment away or question.
Tony would be thrilled not being able to answer your question.
No, you know what? I'll answer it. If you send it and you ask,
I hope
just
a girl
just
remember. What are you talking about? I had sex with them.
Don't ask a question if you
don't want the answer.
But you know what? I've been very, very close. I thought when I was single. And during my single times, I was thinking, okay, you know what? I'm going to go out and I'm going to go. That's it. No more. I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna do what all the people do, and I'm just gonna go on dates and take people out. And then when it gets to that point, it's like, I can't do it.
You just got
And
just gotta be in a relationship.
Yeah. And
what about you, man? Tell me
about.
Sorry,
I fell asleep.
It's okay. You have to have had a bunch. Tell me, you've had a bunch of one night stands. We've talked about.
I've had a lot, but yeah. Again, I was younger, and things do slow down when you get older, and sure. I don't mind saying that. And your values change, right?
I 100% agree.
You know, a lot of things, it would be uncool to say. I don't mind saying, because like you, it's the truth and it's healthy.
Yeah.
But what it's precisely you're asking me? All you see, want to know is numbers. Like there has to be
not just numbers. I'm asking you. Okay, tell me a story about something that was just something that anybody that's watching you that wants to live that celebrity lifestyle. When was a time where you felt like this is everything that kind of everybody wants? When you're in with that woman, the dream, like say the model.
Well, you got to understand. I was active with women before I was ever on television.
Right.
And
yeah, I hope so.
Really?
No, well, I hope so. But I mean, so then you see the clear difference. Well, no, like child stars, I never had a shot.
No, you're right.
Okay.
I agree.
So I had lots of my sexual years where I wasn't on television. And it's just easier. It's just easier because people know who you are. And for whatever reason, they find this world exciting. And, and you take advantage of it.
Okay, what about that superficial level? When you weren't in television, and
that's a whole other train wreck.
When you talk about, it's like, well, you know, that guy's a 5 and she's a 10, whatever else, and not saying that you're a 5.
Thank you.
But now, when you did move into the world of television, did you find that the type of people that were attracted to you changed?
No, because I used to have to work for it before I was on television.
So you don't have to work. You didn't have to work for it as much at that. No.
No. Okay. You know, and then the internet. Because I'm old enough to when that first period of my sexuality happened, teenage years, 20s, and all that. There was no internet.
Right.
So that was a huge.
That was like in the 50s.
A mind blowing thing for me. Like I used to go into chat rooms. I don't know what year it was, but it was because I'm a writer.
Yeah.
So I didn't even and this is. I think the chat rooms were sort of the beginning of what's now Facebook and Twitter.
Yeah, I agree.
And there was no pictures.
Right? You didn't know.
So I was probably talking to a guy from, a truck driver.
No, there's anything wrong with that. But
No. But I'm just saying.
If there were pictures, it would take forever to download that one picture.
Oh, yeah. That was fucking dial-up.
But these kids today and adults today, they have no idea how difficult it used to be.
Chucky says hands don't count, Spenny.
What?
Hands don't count?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Yeah, what does that mean? Don't ask me to.
Your previous sex encounters.
Your previous sex encounters, meaning you jerked off a lot.
Yeah. He says hands
well, yeah,
don't
of
count.
Course.
Yeah, of course.
Well, you didn't, buddy? Who are you? I don't like them already. Starting with me already.
Yeah.
Why, you don't masturbate?
Yeah.
It's always the biggest losers. This guy has probably not been laid in his entire life, and he's talking to me. Now, I'm not going to sit here and brag, because that's not my thing. But if you want to get out in the gutter, buddy, you hit me up on Twitter and Facebook, and we'll go, baby.
Yeah.
Well, if you weren't supposed to masturbate, why would it put your hand so close to, you know.
Yeah, to that region?
Yeah.
Sure.
It's just too simple.
Yeah, sure.
Unbelievable.
Okay, so have you ever, Tony doesn't, he's never tried anal sex, have you? I imagine you're a pretty experimental guy.
That's the delicate art of ass fucking. Yeah. Yes, I've tried it. It's you know, it was like a, not a regular thing usually. There's many, many women for very good reasons, because we all believe in consent and you're doing what like that don't like it. I've been with women who it actually is the only way they can have an orgasm.
Through ass sex?
Correct. Okay. So, you know, I, whatever, right? Like, I'm being honest, like, it's not something that I did a lot, but yeah, occasionally I did do it. It's difficult, too, as if you know. I'm yeah, sure you have.
Yeah.
Sometimes if you're a little bit soft, it's kind of hard to get it in there, right?
Sure, yeah. And, well, it's not hard.
But, why am I doing this? But, you know, it's if it's consenting and people are enjoying it, you know, you do it, right? Everything's complicated to me. Every person's sexuality is complicated.
Right.
Because it deals with their past, it deals with their inhibitions, it deals with their insecurities. So you just have to go on a case-by-case basis.
I agree. Everything is going to be, every person is different, every experience is going to be different. That's mm-hmm, kind of what you're getting at. Mm-hmm. Okay. So when we're on stage together, there's a lot of stuff that gets brought up that's pretty fucked up. Like, we'll bring up stuff about bestiality. That's okay. We'll bring up stuff about bestiality. What else do we bring up? It's pretty, I mean...
Bestiality is pretty much...
Yeah,
pretty much, you know, that's the upper end of weird, you know, then poop sex, you know, that's the extreme end of weirdness. So, you're sort of, I don't know where you're going, you're going to go backwards.
No, I'm trying to just sort of say, like, we talk about some pretty obscure things... But behind closed doors, it sounds like we're all pretty vanilla guys.
No.
You insane vanilla?
No.
Okay, so what are the things that you're into? Are you into BDSM stuff?
Not really. You told me this, and I always knew this, but you put it into words, which is the most erogenous organ that we have is the brain.
Yeah.
And I think
most
that
powerful.
Without getting too specific, I like to
absolutely,
you know, use my brain sexually.
Sure.
And you know, so it's not just a physical experience, it's an intellectual experience, and you know,
absolutely
intellectual might be a bit strong, but you know, that's always been something. And I think it was because I didn't start, every young man usually loses his virginity in a sense to pornography,
yeah,
of our generation. And oddly for me, it was a book, it was like a paperback dirty book,
yeah.
And it should be in the Smithsonian right now, because that got a lot of use, I'm telling you right now. And so that was a story reading, you know. So you can call it role playing, you can call it what you want. Many, many people do it.
Yep.
You know, I'm not talking about costumes, and you know, and many people do that. Nothing wrong with that. But what I'm comfortable saying is that, you know, this is, you know, I never, the S&M thing, I found that there was women that I'd seen when I was single that were quite submissive.
Okay.
They seem to mostly be submissive. And there was an intellectual component to that and a storytelling component to that, which was a turn on for me.
Hmm. Well, I always thought, like, I've had partners, you know, in the past where the mental side of things just weren't there. And
it didn't click intellectually?
No, intellectually, but maybe perhaps it was just a draining experience, you know, living in the world where in some cases there was negativity or it just wasn't there. So I think a lot of that mentally blocked me from actually when we did engage. It was difficult to be in the moment, and I'm thinking, well, maybe it's just because I'm getting older or whatever else, and that's normal erectile dysfunction, everything. But it's not, because it's no frickin' issues now.
For people like me, and I'm sure there's millions, if that component doesn't exist, it's just a void of which could be a huge turn on, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't exist, it's for someone like me, it's not as good. You figure out that as you go through life, and if you're honest about it, you start to realize what it is that turns you on, what you like, what you don't like, and then it's a matter of having the balls to go after it.
So you like your balls play with, speaking of balls?
Yeah, who doesn't?
Any fingers in your ass?
it's happened.
Always, yeah, we're always
mostly by Dr. Les Richmond, who told me I have no polyps. So
it seems like we're always going towards the ass side of things.
Yeah, I don't know why we do that. It's so funny.
You don't know why on the Sean Evans show? I think it's quite clear.
Okay.
Okay, here's this question. How do you anal sex?
Of course. Yeah, it's my
favorite.
Yeah. Well, I like every audience.
Receiving?
Receiving anal sex? I've never... Well, that's not true. I have had one ex-girlfriend that it's called pegging. When you do a role reversal.
Really?
Yeah.
So she wore a strap-on?
Yeah, but it wasn't a strap-on. It didn't look like... I made sure it didn't look like... It didn't resemble a penis at all. And it was... She
what
said...
Did you do?
Here, this is the thing.
Made it look like a barber
pole? It was just like a purple, small little thing that she strapped on. And she just walked out like... All right.
Homophobic.
No, I'm...
That's homophobic.
No, it's not. It's fine. If that's your thing, that's fine. But I'm a heterosexual male.
Right.
And in order for me to get ass sex, she said, well, if you want to fuck me in the ass, I get to fuck you in the ass. I said, all right, well... Is it worth it? And we had, yeah, I'll try anything once or twice. I mean, as a man, I know that there's our G spots are in our asses. So like people can say, oh, you've stuck things in your ass, you're gay, but I don't give a shit if it's with
right.
a female.
I even knew, talk about, and this is a kind of homophobia, I have to say, or maybe it's an assholophobia. I don't know what you'd call it. But I used to work at this car wash. It was a detailing place. And there was this great kid. I'm not going to use his name. But he was a little odd. And I had mentioned something about having oral sex with a woman. To which he said, I would never do that. And I had to, what are you talking about? He goes, too close to the asshole, eh? So there's so many reasons people are flipped out by the whole anal thing.
I love oral sex. That's
oral sex.
Oh, yeah.
So you're a big, yeah, I love oral sex too.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's core play. I don't think it's foreplay. I think it's core play. I think eating.
Core play.
Core play. Yeah.
Chris
going...
Lee just said, did Sean just tell us he got pegged?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, one time, I'm honest, it's happened before. But
Jesus Christ, I got pegged by a big, it was actually, it's a hot dog, but it's called a knocker. Maybe that's Yiddish.
Hot
dog I stuck up my bum on Kenny versus Spenny.
That's true.
These things happen, you
and
know?
It didn't even buy me dinner.
Now, I did have somebody lick my ass.
Yeah, yeah. How did you like that? You got a rim job.
I would ask the girl.
You know what?
Yeah.
She's still vomiting like 10 years ago.
What do you say about rim jobs? Rim jobs are
all
right.
You
yeah,
you don't find, no, you know what?
It's all all right.
It's not.
It's all okay. It's all fine.
I didn't not like it, and I didn't, you know, it was one of those things where if it happened again, it wouldn't matter, but it did happen, and it's like, ooh, that feels different.
Yeah, yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
But it's not nothing that I would say.
Look,
at all.
Guys out there who are comfortable with this, yeah. There's a thing called the prostate.
Yes, let's
which,
talk about
if
this.
If it gets enlarged, you need to have it checked out. That's one side of it.
Sure.
The other side of it is, as Sean mentioned briefly, it will give you maybe the most powerful orgasm you've ever had.
It's yeah.
Now, if your little poo fixation and your anal fixation won't allow you to do that, I think you're missing out. But you have every right to miss out if you want to do that.
Yeah, and you have every right to your opinion about thinking that, you know, that something like that isn't something you want to do or you're not comfortable with. But when you start to explore sex more openly and keep an open mind about things, who really gives a shit what's going on? If you're with someone you care about and they're exploring your body, you're exploring their body, and you're both feeling good and trying new things, I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Chris Lee is regretting he didn't come.
Oh, is he?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is...
C-U-M or C-U-M-E? Is he masturbating watching and he's not coming?
You can still come, Chris. Go for it, buddy. We're here for you. Okay, so let's get back on track here. We've done a lot of ass covering tonight, which is fair because we talk a lot about ass on the shows that we do.
I think ass is an interesting thing to talk about because it's still taboo, even today.
Yeah.
Even you can turn on your computer.
Well, I can think of a lot more taboo things, but we won't get into the whole
yeah. thing. Well, we can, though. That's the thing, is that there's nothing that's really off limits here because the main thing that I think I think that's clear.
Well,
yeah,
I'm talking about scatting and all that stuff.
Okay, scatting, so. Yeah. Again, I mean, scatting, for those of you who don't know what scatting is, that's when... people enjoy sort of shitting on each other or playing with each other's feces. That's not my cup of tea.
It's not my cup of tea either.
But
I just don't wanna,
there's nothing wrong with that for those who do like that, right? I mean, you can't... There's no such thing as normal as long as you're not being...
As long as it's not at the Thanksgiving dinner
table.
And
it's consensual,
you know,
right?
Yeah. Well, it's got to be consensual for sure. But some... Yeah. I didn't think we'd talk about scatting tonight, but I'm not surprised. I'm with the two people to do it.
To me, scatting is Ella Fitzgerald and Cab Calloway, and they must have been thrilled when they co-opted that term.
What about water sports? Have you ever let anyone pee on you?
No, but I peed on someone.
You did pee on someone?
Yes, yeah. You did.
Talk about it at Kenny versus...
That wasn't me.
I talk about it at the Kenny versus... And people are like groaning, like I've said, I took a freaking saw in someone's torso off. Like, it's not the biggest deal in the world. And to be honest, it's not really a sexual thing. really. It's involved in the sexual process, but it's more of a, wow, I'm used to peeing in the toilet.
I don't think
and this girl wants me to pee on her. It's just a new feeling that's different and weird, you know?
I've spoken to people that are into that.
It's called water sports.
Yeah, and I've spoken with girls that said that, yeah, my boyfriend likes it when they, you know, they hover over a coffee table while my boyfriend's underneath and stuff like that. It's like, hey, great. Like, I love listening to these stories because we've heard every story, and I've probably done everything and anything possible on stage.
Yeah.
Performing. So I'm desensitized to all. So when people are telling me this stuff, it's like, yeah, that doesn't faze me, right?
Sure.
But what's interesting is the only difference is when we're out, you know, having dinner or, you know, we're talking about the show and everything's like, yeah, you know, it's felching, you know. And I says, well, it's when a guy sticks or whoever sticks a straw in another man's ass and sucks his own semen out after having sex, right? And we're talking because we're talking about the performance. But then I got to realize, well, the people around us eating dinner that are eavesdropping on a conversation have no idea we're talking about the show or
yeah,
the performance
yeah.
side of things, right?
So I get that too. I get when I'm out for dinner with people, they say, listen, you got to keep your voice down because you talk about sex a lot, but not everybody is used to hearing about the things that you say. It's yeah, I'm getting a nod over here from someone that spends a lot of time with me.
And people judge you, right?
Well, sure.
Which is funny because they shouldn't because they don't know you, right?
It's, yeah.
It's like I'm optically on stage. I'm you know, with the comic book we're doing, we finally found our superhero name.
Okay, go ahead and tell.
So we're Spenny and I we're putting together a comic book called Hypno Bitch, where I control him and I'm this evil hypnotist. But the evil guy is Dr. Demon, and the good person, like when Spenny feels pain, we haven't 100% worked out the optic shit on it. But when
let's just work it out and throw in live, whatever the hell this is.
Am I still your genie?
I become, you'd be his genie.
I'd be his genie,
Mr.
Right.
Angel. So yes. I do things for good. But anyway, so Dr. Demon would be basically the Tony Lee show, but emphasizing it. In the comic book, we're able to go to a whole new level. It's illustrated by Tony Gray, and you know, he's done Spider-Man, Batman, a ton of stuff out there. The Conduit, just an amazing, amazing illustrator.
So we can expect this in September, probably, right?
It's actually going to be done for the Comic-Con in at the end of April is when the comic book will be ready.
But for your show, we're
starting
up in 2017, September?
September time, the Tony Lee side of things for the X-Rated Hypnotist show is going to be collapsing, and the rebirth of two new characters, villain, Dr. Demon, superhero, Mr. Angel, and everything will be doing a PG show, which is PG rated friendly. It's great for all audience base, or it could be Dr. Demon who does the X-rated stuff. Now in the comic book, we're able to emphasize, you know, the twisted things that we do on stage and we talk about are going to be emphasized tenfold. So there's stuff in the book that we'd never be able to do live on stage. Legally, it just wouldn't be possible. So, but or physically, it wouldn't even be possible as well.
So the comic book's going to be fucking edgy.
Well, what's interesting is I think everybody deep down inside has, you know, the Tony Lee character or the optics that people see on Facebook is really maybe 5% of who I am. It's emphasized more, so people think I'm that guy. But 95%... of me isn't that guy, which gets me back to the thing where you know, people are always out there prejudging you, thinking that sexually you're this monster.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And but the reality is I'm not. I'm certainly going to disappoint if you think you're going to if I'm that, you know,
right,
that monster that people think, that aggressive whatever. I'm just that guy that.
Who's the monster? Bill Cosby. I mean, this is
well, yeah, it's the opposite, right?
Yeah,
yeah. So it's the opposite. You got a good guy that all of a sudden has been painted or has put himself in a position where he's become this monster. And then you've got myself, for example, who portrays this monster for the last 32 years on stage.
I don't know if they... You're not a monster on stage.
No, but you know what? But in the eyes of...
The politically correct...
What people think. And it's really the complete opposite. Which goes back to, you know, here we are, an X-rated hypnotist and everything, and we're, I like to think of us as being the leading edge in promoting consent, promoting,
100%.
Spreading the word for violence against women and stopping a lot
and
of
people.
The variations. It's because we understand the dynamic of people's psychology, and we understand how to engage people, and now we're using what we've done from from our experiences and delivering a positive message in an entertaining way without taking away the gravity of what the situation is.
Right. Okay. So let's get back to Spenny brought up a good point, the mind being the most powerful and largest sexual
organ. I didn't know it was the most powerful. For me, it's powerful, so I'm not surprised.
Right.
You were the one who enlightened me to the...
Right. So that's why, I mean, when you guys watch and you like the page Sex and Suicide, the reason being is mental health, people don't think the two tie in together, but they very much do. If you're not taking care of yourself mentally, your sex life will suffer. I promise you, it will. So it's really important, and we obviously want to make sure that people, when we say sex and suicide, we're not encouraging suicide by any means. We're encouraging the conversation about people that have taken their own lives and trying to prevent that from happening and open the sort of the floodgates for people to start sharing things that make them mentally healthy. Have you guys, in your experience, on this whole journey that you've gone through, where people are judging you, like you said, people might see you as a monster, how has that played an effect on your mental health over the years?
To me, it doesn't make an effect because it's the optics is what people think about me is what people want when they come and see the show. That's what we give them. We give them we give them an aggressive guy that makes them laugh, that rides that line of what's funny, not funny, and everybody has a great experience with it. But it's a real science to keep it there without going overboard. And we've done you can't do 9,000 plus shows in a third few year span and have such a great reputation in the industry. Even last year we got inducted in the Canadian Hall of Fame.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And
we're pretty confident.
It was rewarding being acknowledged for all the work that we've done over the years and
sure. What about you, buddy? Going from being sort of a guy that was just creating a show to being on these talk shows and being known across LA and things, did that create anxiety within you? Did you have any struggles mentally, or did you handle it well?
Well, I think, I'm a child of a divorced family at a pretty rough age, so I had to deal with all kinds of depression-ish issues all through my life. When it came to TV, the amount of, and you can talk about this, because you mentioned it to me, the amount of supposed hatred I get on my social media, now I sort of understand it and I play along with it. But when it first started happening, it was like, what have I signed up for?
Sure.
I mean, these people are vicious, and they're vicious, you know?
Yeah.
But what I've come to know is the most vicious people sometimes when I try to engage with them through social media, within two or three back and forths, they say, dude, I love you. I love the show.
Yeah.
And that's, I'm not just saying that to save face. There are people out there that probably think I'm the biggest idiot in the world. That's fine.
Sure.
But that's been my experience. I've had two, I would say, negative experiences with the haters. So the mental health side of things, at first it was sort of, if you're an insecure person or whatever, it's going to, that's what they try to do, right?
Right.
They try to get a reaction out of you.
Yeah.
And I fell into that trap early on.
So did I. I think that I did the exact same thing. I think going on to The Bachelorette, I still thought everybody would love me, right? It's not the case at all.
No.
You have to be okay with being able to accept, and that's what this is about too. I know that not everybody's going to like me, and I'm okay with that. The key is to be yourself in a world and be okay with people that don't like you and just say, hey, that's okay, that's them.
Now there's this platform that didn't exist when I was younger.
This social media platform.
Social media platform, which allows if the person that's a celebrity, whatever you want to call them, and they're putting themselves out there, you have access to that person in a way that never existed before.
True, true.
And unfortunately, there's a lot of negativity out there. I can only imagine what a Kim Kardashian,
has gone through.
Or what they get, And
yeah.
But then as the person, you realize that you need the social media to promote. And then you just get a little bit of a hard skin and you don't
right.
let it bug you.
I think, I don't care what people think. I've got a few people in my life, or a group of... quite a lot of people in my life that know me as who I am, and the rest of it really doesn't matter. Actually, to me it's amusing now. So if people think I'm that person, or they're messaging me, or they're messaging other people. So this guy, do you know who this guy is? Blah blah blah. Well, you take a look on Facebook. Yeah. You know, in one sense, you got me making people screw chairs, have an orgasm. Another video, I'm beating somebody up in a cage and everything because I did MMA for a while. So every optic out there looks like I'm this freaking demon. Hence the fact we came up with Dr. Demon, because that's the persona that I have on social media. And so those people and we don't have a lot of haters at all. No. Except maybe that...
the politically correct higher-ups sometimes.
Well, sometimes they, but we don't have a lot of them. But the ones they do, I just got to laugh at it, because I know that the people that know me, and, they're the ones that go, no, you know what, he's a nice guy.
Yeah.
You know, he's a simple, down-to-earth guy that...
But Kenny versus Spenny specifically was the kind of show that engenders... winners and losers and immaturity and that high school kind of thing. And so I have to take responsibility that I did that. So I'm not complaining about it. Oh, God, no.
You never regret any, like...
I don't regret.
Because you kind of... Would you agree you've kind of been a little bit pigeonholed into this character your whole life?
I know, but you can look down the line at most people that are in the business, never mind the level that I'm on, and you kind of get pinholed into the thing that was most popular.
Typecast.
Right.
Yeah,
sure.
So, but I do other things, as you know. I do music, I do sex toy bingo, I do shows with you.
Well, the comic book that we're...
The comic, yeah, we're comic lots, books. Yeah, I write a sex advice column, you know. Which,
let's talk about that.
Oh, wait a second. Sorry, okay. Let me finish. Can I finish my point?
Go ahead.
So in a weird way, I just love being creative. And as you know, doing something that you love and getting paid for it is a real gift. So,
100%.
So I just put my head down and keep doing the work. And, am I bad Brad Pitt? No. But am I making a living? Yes. And I'm enjoying myself. And for all the haters out there who, they love to say, oh, you're doing sex toy bingo and you're a loser, your career's over. It's okay. You know what? I'm not about pleasing you. I'm about, pleasing myself.
It's been a blast, though, hasn't it? We've had a blast.
I've been saying this to Tony and to Sean, that the live stuff is,
it's a lot
for
of
me,
fun.
Is an amazing thing. You don't reach as many people, but you get to do a lot of work.
But that's what this is for, hopefully. If we can spread this through colleges and universities and do something like this on a regular basis, now people have another way to reach us and to tune in that they didn't have before.
Yeah, we could think of some pretty cool topics.
Right? So, so one of the other things I wanted to ask you about, and I know you didn't really want me to bring this up.
Thank
but
you.
But we've shared some long car rides together, and we've talked about a war, specifically.
You shouldn't even go there.
You shouldn't even go there?
No, not really, because you're breaking a bro code of some kind. No, I just, I'm a minor philosophical thinker, and I think about things, and I try to make sense of things. Now, I'm happy to talk about another aspect of it, which is essentially that, and this was a guy named Dennis Prager, who's a radio talk show host in California. I don't know if it shows across the country, it's probably syndicated. Very smart guy, and he said something one day about, there's no difference between the races. We're all fundamentally the same. We may speak different languages, come from different cultures. However, with the sexes, there's a difference. So that really felt true to me based on my experience, okay? And so it created a few philosophies, one of which I don't really want to get into.
Okay.
But then it got me to think a lot about the games we play when we're single and trying to find a mate or someone to get laid with. And there was that old thing where we all know somebody who's chasing after someone who treats them like shit, right?
Yep, absolutely.
And by the way, this is what I can't stand. We're now having a general conversation, okay? So a general conversation is just that. There are many exceptions. So don't fucking write, I know a girl who's, or I know a guy. We all know they exist. This isn't 100% science. This is just, just trying to make sense.
I've never played games. I've never had this. The new girl.
That's why you never had anal.
The new girl that I'm with, I'll tell you something. She's fun. I never have played. It was like from the beginning get go. I said, fuck it. I'm just going to say how it is. And that's it. It's not, I don't want to play. Why do I want to play those games again?
So you like the direct approach? It's working
out?
Yeah,
it's worked.
Yeah.
And, it's.
I basically said I don't want someone to talk specifically. You've done just exactly what I've asked everyone not to do.
You just
jumped right in. I love
you know,
it.
You know what, though? I blame the audio engineers running at 115 decibels of sound pressure in my ear on stage every night.
What? You can't hear me is what you're saying.
I just smile and nod.
Okay. So go ahead, continue.
No, well, just, you know, this isn't a theory I came up with, but it's something that I feel like I've came up with it, but I'm sure a lot of people have come up with it if they think about it, and which is that, well, how is that phenomenon happening? Why, if someone's treating you like shit, you want them? And the only thing I could think of is that we know each other, we live in our souls and in our bodies. So we know all of our quirks and insufficiencies, right? Yep. So fundamentally, somewhere deep inside, we must think that we're not all that. We may do a couple of things that are great, but we know that we're fallible, we know our downsides, we know our weaknesses. So when you pick a mate, right, that is, this is the classic, like you the movies, what is it with Vince Vaughn and single
breakup.
No, there's Vince Vaughn and the director now. It was their first movie, you know, Your Money, John Favreau.
Swingers. Yeah.
Had that great scene where John Favreau meets a girl. Vince tells him exactly what to do, how to play the game.
Yep.
And he can't do it. And he calls this person over, and the answering machine keeps dying. Yeah. And he has to call her back 6 times, and he totally blows it.
Yeah.
And the reason is, in my opinion, why that is because if you fundamentally see yourself as flawed, then anyone who likes you that much has to be retarded. You know, can I say that? And a lot of this is subconscious. It may be conscious in some people, but when you see someone who doesn't pay attention to you, when you see someone who's involved in their own lives and their own business, it's very attractive because you're feeling you're somehow moving up. And I hate to use up and down, but that's, sure, I think, the easiest way to say it. So that's why people are attracted to people that sometimes don't treat them as well, and why they're push away people that are over the top. I want to be with you, you know, because there is a game that's being played. Tony, you couldn't be an exception, but there's a, whether you're in a relationship, a marriage, games play out. I think that, because I think the total honesty oftentimes doesn't exactly work the way it should, you know.
No, I agree with you. And the perfect example is when Sex and the City, when they'd always be like, what does he mean when he says this? Or, mm-hmm, and they'd have this whole conversation about maybe he just means what he said, you know?
Right,
so,
right.
Yeah, but I get what you're saying, for sure. Is there anything else you want to elaborate on that war, that battle, or
I don't really want to elaborate on it, because it's like, you know, it would be like, you know, Eisenhower telling, you know, Hitler, you know, where he was going to invade. You gotta keep your cards and, you know, hang on to them, because if my wife finds out what I'm thinking, I'm dead.
I don't even know.
Then she'll completely dominate me, which she does anyways. But anyhow, no, you gotta keep a little mystery in these things and realize women are different, men are different.
So
it's not a good or bad thing. It's just the thing.
So do you feel this way even in marriage with your wife? There's still a bit of a game being played.
I don't know if she has her own secret. She could be on another podcast now. I don't know. I don't know how you could avoid it when you live with someone, you love them, you've got children, you've got complications. There's all kinds of stuff that goes on. There's lots of power playing. There's lots of control things that go on.
Do you think that the exchange of power has a lot to do with it, and who has the upper hand?
Well, I could say it this way, that I think, and most women won't admit this, and is that the guy who's just 100% honest, is not a bastard in any way, does everything she asks, cleans, puts the toilet seat down, isn't a guy, basically, because guys are sloppy and we're stupid, we're not as smart as men, that's what I think, then I don't think that's a turn on. Now, well, there'll be exceptions, Tony Lee. There will be some women that really will like a guy like that, but to me, they're not a guy anymore, they're something else.
I can still hear you.
Yeah.
That's just we all take in the world through our filters, and this is what I've come up with. So,
sure,
you know, now a lot of women would say, no, I want my man to be responsible, this and that. I don't think they do. It's most people. I don't think they really do. They won't admit it. They won't even think about it.
Okay.
But we're different. And men have to be men and women have to be women. Nothing to do with the workplace, nothing to do with misogyny, nothing to do with any of that. Just the day-to-day things that go on in life.
Fair enough. So you're still saying that even though we want to both be looked at as equals, there's still obvious differences between the sexes. And I guess that even in sort of a marriage, like the one that you're in, there's always going to be a little bit of...
especially in a marriage.
Especially in a marriage.
Sure.
So would you say that what we're talking about is there's always a negotiation taking place almost?
Yeah, but it's not overt, right? It's,
it doesn't have to be an all negotiation.
Maybe not, but you can
maybe
be
maybe you found somebody perfect and you're both on the perfect, you know, both think alike, no negotiations. Like, hey.
You're in the honeymoon phase. You're not allowed to talk like this.
Yeah, honeymoon phase. Yeah,
honeymoon, if you're in a honeymoon phase,
none of this applies.
Yeah, none of this applies. But yeah, I get that. I get that you're saying. And I think that it's great how you're viewing your relationship. And I hope it stays that way, 100%.
Yes. Well, yeah.
And I know that you're happily married, but you have obviously gone past the honeymoon stage. And we all have daughters as well, right? Which is kind of unique because we're sitting here talking about sex and talking about things openly. Like, what kind of man do you want your daughters to end up with? I know I want one that's going to be, treat her well, that's going to be the guy.
No, because my daughters, very privately, I'm going to teach them.
You're gonna teach them.
Well, yeah, there'll be no bro code with them.
No.
Right? Yeah. But yeah, you know, look, you wanna. I'm not saying that you you beat the women. And
I know what you're saying.
You know, I don't know. I think it would be absurd for me to imagine what, because I think that the personalities are complicated, and personalities that are thrown into monogamy and marriage and all the responsibilities that go with it even complicates it more. Obviously, on a bare bones way, you want someone that's going to treat my daughter well, and I mean, they're very young. It's absurd to even be talking about this, and you know, someone who's good and bad. I'm talking about the kinds of dynamics I'm talking about are very subtle and very nuanced.
Sure, sure.
You know, we're not talking about it's okay to you know, beatings are never okay.
No, obviously,
any of that's okay.
Obviously,
we're living in
you know, but if here's something you'll like. If she ends up marrying, let's say, a cheater, right? That's going to be her issue, not my issue at that point. Do I want that? Obviously not if she couldn't handle it. But you know what? That's how you learn about life. You live it and you react to the things that happen in life, and you can't teach that stuff.
Right. I guess that's a good point. And what I'm trying to
say, and she could be cheating. You know, who knows?
Right. And but you and I, yeah, we hope not. I mean, obviously we hope down the road that I don't think, and this is my thing, right? I mean, I think that as long as people are open and honest, I mean, today I just watched a porn that had like 30 people having a massive orgy, and I was just thinking, you know,
really busy. He's really busy.
Yeah, really busy. But I didn't think. I was thinking, like, man, I don't think I could. As hard as I try to be open minded about these things, I still don't think with my partner down the road, as much as I want to explore new things with them, I don't think I want to share them.
29
with
other people in the room.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's fine.
Still,
that's just the preference.
Yeah,
there's
yeah,
a certain breed of.
Yeah.
Well, there's a certain breed of people who think that, and the swinging lifestyle, and you know, again, it's consensual. It's not my thing. Never was. I actually went to an orgy in L.A. many, many years ago, and I watched, and it was a big turnoff for me.
So voyeurism, you were the
voyeur. No, I wasn't even a voyeur. I just did it because I wanted the experience. It was a house in the hills of Hollywood that every week, Sunday or Friday, I don't remember, they would have this orgy. And I was invited, not necessarily to participate, and I didn't.
Right.
And it was just, you know, you just find out what you like and what you don't like.
Yeah.
If you don't experience things, you can't make a decision.
I agree. Good job. What about you? Have you ever had any? So you've never had a threesome? Have you ever had a threesome? Or multiple? Yes.
Yeah, but I mean, it was so pathetic. I mean, it was just, there was so much begging and pleading and drunkenness. It was honestly, if they filmed it, it would probably be a number one on YouTube for the just laughter, but that was a long, long time ago. And when I see threesomes in porn, it was nothing like that. It was absolutely nothing like that.
What was it like? Describe it in more detail.
It's too awkward and pathetic.
What was pathetic about it?
Well, because I wanted a threesome.
Yeah.
Because I'm a guy, and I'd be honest about it, I was single.
Was it two girls? Two women?
Two British women. They were a lot older than me, and I'm very drunk. I can't go into the details, but it was just, they were laughing a whole lot. Laughing's not good for me. You know, and they kind of knew what I wanted, and they weren't really into it, but they thought I was so funny and pathetic that they kept it going. It was just, honestly.
This sounds like the best story ever.
Well, no.
Not for you.
No,
but
he has the best story ever.
You have the best story ever?
Well, I don't know if we can repeat it. It's not you weren't in it, but it's someone you know. And I.
That one. Oh,
God. You don't have to name names. It's generic.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I had a friend of mine that there was he was on Tinder. And
fucking Tinder.
He was driving along, and a girl had called him up and said, you know, well, I'm going to give you a blowjob. And he goes, okay.
Total strange.
I'll go. So he pulls into town and really doesn't know what to expect. And, you know, he sees a ramp. And, you know, and
Please be careful now. I can
see it. I'm trying to optically, because it's going to seem very, but I'm not.
No one's listening.
There's a great story behind this, actually. So he goes in, and okay, the girl is physically disabled.
I know the story. You know,
so he walks in, but and the way he tells the story is, it's wonderful, because here's this beautiful woman that you know, for whatever happened, has put her in this position.
Oh my God, you're ruining the story with all this.
Okay,
crap.
Okay, all right.
No,
so,
I had good.
Her Tinder picture didn't show she was disabled.
Well, it did, but he wasn't sure of the gravity of it. So
maybe she was in a motorcycle accident.
Yeah, she was completely disabled. So she was a quadriplegic. He came in, and he didn't know, and he said, you know, look, let's just talk and whatever else. He goes, no, I really want to do this for you. And he's thinking, well, I don't know if I can get it to work, right? But he did, because
apparently she gave a pretty good blowjob too.
You know what he said afterwards, as he was telling the progression how this happened? He goes, one of the best blowjobs I ever had in my life.
Now here's the best part, which I don't know if you remember, which is that she swallowed and then he didn't kiss her goodbye.
And his friends gave him a hard time, but you know, the way I look at it is, think about that.
He totally doesn't know his story is being aired right now. That's awesome.
Well, we didn't mention any names.
No names, but some people watching.
But and they know exactly who I'm talking about. But it's wonderful, because he's such a great guy, right?
Yeah.
And he didn't prejudge, and he followed through, and you know, God bless this girl that is in this situation, for her to reach out, and that's going back to the mental health thing. God, you know what?
God bless the quadriplegic who's using Tinder to blow strangers. God bless her.
But that's ballsy.
It is.
She could sit. She could sit back. And
oh gosh. Anyway. So yeah.
Oh,
so
no.
We appreciate the fact. All right.
So anyways, if there's anything that I've enjoyed most on this podcast besides his ponytail, it's watching him tell the story and fully realizing before he started that there was a quadriplegic and try to make it politically correct and lovely. That was the greatest moment that maybe ever
God.
Had.
Okay.
Legal department says with the topic. Okay, so anyways, that's a great story. Should we end up there for tonight? Is there anything else? What are the messages? I mean, besides this woman and her being strong enough to use Tinder and do these things.
I think the overriding message is quadriplegics give great power.
No.
Which makes sense, because
they
can't use their arms and their legs, so they're probably pretty good with them.
On the mental side, you can say whatever you want. Reach out. Do what you do. Doesn't matter what disposition or position you're in. Do what feels right. Do what feels right. Because
I kiss the broad at the end if you swallow it, for Christ's sake. Give her a kiss. You don't have to stick your tongue.
Oh, God. All right. So anyways, is there anything else that we want to talk about? Not about the quadriplegic story, but just in general. What advice do we want to give to people, young people, the people that we do shows for today?
Find someone genuine. Love them. Don't prejudge us for who you think I am, who you think Spenny is, because we may be wonderful people.
Or I want you to prejudge me.
Not.
It's the only way I have to, you know, honestly.
Or not. Oh, my God.
Like I said, my wife, if she saw Kenny versus Spenny, the lawyer would be on the phone so fast and make your head spin.
Yeah. So
actually, she's going to the show in Oshawa. So,
yeah, that's right. April
her first time seeing
Kenny and Spenny
in Oshawa.
Kenny.
Okay, so if you guys want to see Kenny versus Spenny live, it's what, April 1st in Oshawa.
Yeah, and then we'll be at the Comic Con. Kenny and Spenny will be there also doing a show at the Laugh Shop at the end of April, as well as doing the Comic Con itself, and we'll have the Comic Hypno Bitch where Mr. Angel will be performing.
Is it the PG show?
Yeah, the PG show, but Dr. Demon will also be doing a
nightclub.
The villain side of the show outside of the Comic-Cons as well.
Cool.
And I'd like to thank Sean for doing this, for being Sean.
Thank you.
I met him. We started working together. He's funny. He's smart. And he's trying to make a difference. And I think that really
Absolutely.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
All kidding aside. And come out and see us when we...
We do our show.
It's entertaining, and you'll you know, hopefully
help us promote consent, equality,
mental health.
Yep.
And we've also got, we're working on sex trivia.
Yes.
It's gonna be like, who wants to be a millionaire? Who wants to be a sexpert or sextraordinaire? We haven't quite decided on the name.
Yeah. So actually, we have some big prizes and everything to give away. We're gonna talk about some interesting topics, and it's like trivia on steroids, basically.
Absolutely, and all about in obviously 18 plus.
Yeah.
I mean, it's gonna be. X-rated, well, not X-rated, but...
No, it will have adult content. It's going to vary from campus to campus, depending on what campus you are at or what venue you come into. Most off venues will be R-rated or
awesome.
Won't be X-rated. But.
Sure. Well, we'll have fun. So we hope to see everyone out soon, and thanks for tuning in. We will see you tomorrow. I've got a special guest coming for Mental Health and Motivational Monday for the podcast tomorrow night, so tune into that. Also a special guest on Wednesday for Women Fresh Wednesday. So that's it. Thank you for coming, Spenny. Thanks, Tony. I appreciate it. And we'll see you guys. I'll see you guys soon, but we'll see you guys soon as well. Thanks for tuning in.